name something like not equal to, and then, you know, one, for example. And this would pretty much list all the people with a name not equal to one, whereas you never really want that to happen. So it's like a classic case of NoSQL injection. Hey everyone, welcome back. My name is Mehul, and in this video, we'll be taking a look at what do I mean by when I say in the title, why backend developers should be paranoid developers. Let's go. If you're new here, make sure you leave a like, subscribe to the channel, and hit the bell icon. This is free of cost and helps the channel grow. So in order to understand a little bit of architecture, what happens is that this is your client. Again, this is something we should discuss all the time. And this is your server, right? Whatever your server sends to your client, index.html, XYZ, whatever it is, more scripts, this gets executed on the client side, right? So technically, even if there is something wrong, some sort of virus or anything, or, you know, if this computer is on fire or something is happening, you don't care, right? You just say that, hey, this is my job. I just sent you something, and whatever you do, you blow up your computer with that, that's fine by me. But the way web works is that this computer can communicate with this backend as well. And this backend right here is a trusted source. You trust it with all your heart. Why? Because your database, which is connected, which contains all the sensitive secrets and stuff, has most likely unlimited access to the information, which is the case with most of the applications. Until you are, you know, Facebook level, then you have segregation access even for the backend APIs. But the idea is that you don't want this server to be compromised. So as a job of a backend developer, you have to be extremely paranoid about web security. As a front-end developer, you can pretty much ship anything you want here. It would not affect you, but as a backend developer, it is your job to make super solid security measures so that this payload right here never really crashes, corrupts, does anything which you don't want to your database or to your application layer as well. Okay, so with that being said, let's also understand what is this payload right here and how you can work with it in a safe way. There, here are my 4 or 5 tips. Let's see how many there are. So this payload is any information which this client sends to the server. Some of the ways is, you know, the standard HTTP methods, post, port, patch, and using them, you can get them in headers. Or for these methods, you can have something like body, content inside body, or you can upload a file, which is again, technically content inside body, but with different content type, right? So what you want to do as a first level of security is that you always want to check the size of the payload you are receiving. And ideally, this should be configured on the reverse proxy which you have, or if you're using a managed service, then it should most likely be taken care of. But you should want to restrict the size to a certain sane limit. Right? Let's say you are creating a form which accepts a contact message, right? Then of course you don't want this message, or you don't want this input field, let's say, which is upload file, to be more than 2 or 3 MBs, right? Because let's say if you are storing this, if you're, you know, not even using S3 or anything similar, and you store this on your server with your other files, there's a high possibility someone can just crash your server by uploading a 50 GB file here, and you will just process the complete upload and that's it. Your server goes boom. So making sure the size of the payload is in limits is an important factor to consider as a paranoid backend developer. Then once you cover the very broader sense of the payload, you want to go a little bit deep into the payload and try to figure out the type of the payload. Now, this is an area where a lot of injections and stuff can arrive if you're not right, especially in the NoSQL world. You can have a lot of NoSQL injections. And what do I mean by that? Let's say you have a query for NoSQL, which runs something like db.query, and then you have a is equal to request.body.name, right? So I'm not able to write it completely, but the idea is that this thing right here, you're expecting, let's say this is not name, this is name as a field inside of the NoSQL database. Now, if you're not checking the type of this request.body, it might very well be possible that somebody, instead of passing this as a string, pass this as an object. So the query becomes name something like not equal to, and then, you know, one, for example. And this would pretty much list all the people with a name not equal to one, whereas you never really want that to happen. So it's like a classic case of NoSQL injection. So you don't want that. How you can fix that is actually make sure the types of the body you're requesting are actually what, you know, you expect as well. So a handy library for this, which I can recommend, is Joey. So Joey is a package which can help you with writing schemas for the data you want to accept and then execute them automatically instead of just doing a manual if type of and stuff like this, which gets cumbersome and boring super quick. So Joey is what you want to use. The third one is Contents of the Payload, which is again more relevant for SQL injection rather than NoSQL ones. So Contents of the Payload just means that, for example, select star from blah blah blah, where name is equal to whatever your body is, right? You don't want to do this. Why? Because somebody can just insert a single quote, write a SQL statement and comment out the rest. Classic SQL attack. So you don't want this to happen. What you want is you want to inspect the contents as well in these cases, escape it, do whatever you want. Or in this case, in this specific case, at least you should build the queries yourself, you know, using the query builder and any other safety measure included in the language. So inspect, introspect the contents of the query and don't just randomly pass user input without actually knowing a lot more information about the user input. What is the type, what is the size, what is the content, and so on. Number four is rate limit. So it might be possible that you have an expensive CPU intensive endpoint which the user can exploit. So let's say you have an endpoint which spikes your CPU usage with 2% for, I don't know, like 2 seconds, right? Maybe you're taking a screenshot of a website at this endpoint. So what somebody can do if this endpoint is not rate limited is they can just constantly DOS it with a very simple script written on their computer and bring your server, you know, to 80 to 90% usage, which might affect experience for other people on your server, right? So you don't want this to happen. So always try to rate limit your API endpoints. This is like, again, in the super basic things, just like we have size of payload, you should also have a rate limit set on every single API endpoint you have, at least for public. The fifth one is encryption of sensitive data. So if you're doing anything that even remotely, if it involves the use of credit cards or, you know, passwords or anything which neither should you know or somebody else know, then you should store this information very carefully. At least for passwords, you don't even have to just encrypt them, you can just hash them, right? So for example, for passwords, one of the good libraries is bcrypt. So bcrypt is a hashing algorithm as well as available as a standalone library, which just takes your input, which could be any sort of length, and just spits out some random garbage stuff. The good thing about this garbage stuff is that although this is random, this cannot be used to derive the original password. So what does this mean? In case your database ever gets hacked or gets leaked or somebody sees it, they can see all the public information, but they would not be able to see the passwords, right? So this is like super, super duper important that you have the proper encryption wherever you are using this sensitive data. And the sixth one is ports and services. By ports and services, what I mean is that only expose the things on internet which absolutely needs to be on internet. You absolutely never really want to expose as much as you want on internet. In most cases, what you want is just expose port 80 and 443 on your server, right? You never really want the MongoDB sitting on 27017 or the Redis sitting on some port number, Memcache sitting on some port number to be exposed on internet. Bare minimum services should be made available, and most of them, and if not all of them, should also be routed with a reverse proxy, because a reverse proxy allows you to add a lot of these things, rate limiting, for example, size of payload as well. All these checks in languages like C and C++, if you're using, I mean, you don't have to necessarily write C and C++. The code would be executed very fast. It's compiled to your machine code, you know, the native code, and this is like a battle tested software if you're using Nginx or HAProxy as well. So make sure you also follow these practices of having least possible services exposed on internet. On intranet or on VPC, that's fine. But on internet, make sure that you don't expose more than what's needed. And the seventh one and the final one, which I can think at least for now, is disabling introspection. Now, what happens is, at least for what I know for tools like GraphQL and Firebase or Supabase or tools like these, what they allow is they allow people to introspect their endpoints. What is introspection? Introspection is a practice where the end client can provide auto completions or some additional smart features, but in return, your server actually pretty much sends them all the available information it has, all the available metadata it has for a particular thing. For example, GraphQL sends the full schema structure, more or less. If you ever visited localhost, you know, if it is running on localhost and slash GraphQL, you would see that the graphical interface which it shows allows you to do auto completion and it very nicely completes it. But if you ever ship that on production, that pretty much means everyone knows all the queries, all the mutations, all the resolvers which you have. This thing is more about security by obscurity, which is not good, but this is important. Security by obscurity should not be your primary method of defense, but definitely once you have followed these six, also make it impossible for attackers, or at least very hard for attackers, to discover what are exactly some of the maybe vulnerable endpoints at your end, right? So disable introspection on your GraphQL layer, on your REST layer if you're using any sort of framework, on your database layer if you're using these Firebase, Supabase, these databases. So make sure you do that. So yep, that's pretty much it for this video. Hopefully you were able to understand a few important programming slash security practices following this video. If you did, make sure you leave a like, subscribe to the channel, and let me know in the comments below which one was your favorite. So that is all for this video. I'm gonna see you in the next one really soon. If you're still watching this video, make sure you comment down in the comment section, I watched this video till the end. Also, if you're not part of CodeDamn's Discord community, you are missing out a lot on events which we organize on a weekly basis to code. You already know the drill. Make sure you like the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, and thank you so much for watching.